of Arjuna about what is jnanam and what is gnayam. Okay, so what we saw is Lord Krishna, this question can be answered in many different ways. The way Lord Krishna chose to answer the question is, for jnanam he gave all the values that are necessary for person to understand what Vedanta is talking about. Okay, so that jnanam included amanitvam, adambitvam, okay, lack of pretense, not depending upon others' respect for your well-being, ahimsa, non-violence, okay, then certain amount of commitment, then looking at acharya upasanam, seeing the importance of teacher in this whole learning, sthairyam, a certain amount of commitment. So these were the things that were talked about as necessary for a person to understand Vedanta. Okay? And what was gnayam? Gnayam is anadimat param brahma. What you need to know is not just a simple thing, but one very big reality about yourself, you being Brahman. Okay? So that is the ultimate goal. So therefore, what is the difference between a mumukshu and a normal ethical person? Okay? Because people are not really sure. People think that the whole teaching of Gita is dharma pursuit. Dharma pursuit means how to be a good human being, how to conduct in this world, how to kind of, you know. But actually, if you understand this verse, you understand that the Gita is moksha shastra. It's not dharma shastra. Okay? Moksha shastra means the commitment of Gita is to make you see a much bigger reality about yourself than what you know. Okay? So that, and in order to know that reality, you need to cultivate certain values. So that means the ethical life, cultivating proper values, proper attitudes, compassion. This is what we think is an end in life. According to Gita, this is a means to an end. Okay? The end is moksha, and this is a means to an end. Without this, the ultimate knowledge cannot take place. And this is why Vedanta is also different from what we nowadays see as modern day New Age spirituality, which talks about oneness. Just this morning, I had somebody in the class, and he had exposed himself to this New Age thinking. And the whole problem is they keep on focusing about, you know, this oneness, one reality which is undivided, and they don't think about realigning their relative life, okay, according to, they just ignore, they dismiss it as something which is not very real, so therefore they don't pay attention to it. What Vedanta says is you can't afford not to pay attention to it, because your whole life is lived in this relative world. All your decision making is in this relative world. You can't just afford to say it is transient, it is more cha it is changing all the time, it is not real, and therefore you're just going to kind of, you know, ignore it. That attitude leads to problem of what we call dissociation. Dissociation means you're removed. Neither you understand the final reality that Vedanta is talking about, nor you what improve yourself or grow as an individual and become more responsible and more ethical and more nuanced person. You just, because you dismiss the whole world as only like an as though reality, the ultimate thing is this knowledge about oneself. That is a very dangerous, you know, position to have, because you know, you tend to think that you are above dharma. You tend to think that you're bigger than Ishvara. That is disastrous. Okay? So therefore, you need to, it's very, very delicate. This whole knowledge is very delicate, and it has to be very properly handled, because otherwise it just creates ideas which are so far removed from the truth. So far removed. You're much more subjective than earlier if you don't understand Vedanta right. If you start thinking you're bigger than Ishvara, what That is so much of a delusion. Okay, so therefore, this is what it says, that until you have all these values where you understand things properly, then only this Jnayam is, you know, what is to be known is to be known by you. Okay, so that was already we have discussed. Now, the next model of human growth is talked about, and this is chapter 14, verse 5. Okay, so another way of looking at, you know, what does it entail to grow as a human being, here a model is used. So we will chant the verse, Sattvam rajastama iti guna prakriti sambhavaha nibadnanti mahabaho dehe dehinam avyayam. So will you chant after me? Sattvam rajastama iti guna prakriti sambhavaha nibadnanti mahabaho dehe dehinam avyayam. Okay, so here he says that there are three, you know, you can the world, when you see people who are different. Okay, so that means, how will you define, or how will you even describe different people? How will you define? Because each one is so multidimensional, everybody is so different from the other, and if you begin to describe each person, even you cannot totally describe yourself, how are you going to describe everybody else? That's why you need a framework. Okay? Why Gita creates a framework? Because you need to somehow understand human nature. And once you understand human nature from a certain framework, then you can grow within that framework. It gives you a certain kind of a capacity to see where are you in your attitudes. Otherwise, how will you know? Okay. So here is a framework that is used, which is what we call sattva, rajas and tamas. Okay. So that means one thing is very important for us to understand, that all of us have all three of them. Okay, it's not possible to have one person only sattvic and the other person only tamasic. It's not possible. Okay, so according to our shastra, a human being is mixture of punya and papa. Mixture of punya and papa means that is why you have some experiences which are pleasurable, you know, which give you a lot of pleasure, and there are some experiences which give you a little feeling of difficulty, struggle and all that. So that means everybody has to go through certain pleasures and pains in life. This is why the division that we make generally, that somebody is privileged. We have a tendency to make a bipolar opinion, right? This person is good, that person is bad. Okay, this person is generous, that person is stingy. So that means, and we have this is highly ethical, this is totally, taken to all the lies. So that means this bipolar opinion about anybody, there is no truth in it. I mean, there is some truth in it, but it is not totally nuanced truth. So therefore, one has to learn to understand oneself and others with nuance, right? Because even I am not totally good and I am not totally bad either. All of us have a certain way, that some areas that we require to grow. So how to identify that? Okay, so therefore, even though all human beings are combination of sattva, rajas and tamas, you still can call somebody predominantly sattvic, right? So that means all three are there, but what actually, it's all the game of percentage. Okay, so therefore you can say this person is predominantly sattvic, means mostly the person is, what is sattvic? First of all, you need to understand what is sattvic. How would you define sattvic? sattvic can represent in, even sattvic can manifest in so many different forms. Okay, so there is one way that sattva can represent in terms of what? Your clarity of thinking, your intellect. That means when you understand things, you don't mix up things, you understand things accurately. This is a sattvic mind, a mind which is able to capture whatever is being taught what accurately. Right? The second way in which sattva can manifest is what? The person is a kind human being. Last time Neeru was talking about, I love the term you gave, and that is what? I call her Mahalakshmi. What was the term? Mahalakshmi. Right? Beautiful term. Imagine, right? What she was saying is that this person is such a giver, okay? So is such a big heart, right? That is sattva. It's not just your intellect. Okay? This here, sattva is manifesting as very good-heartedness. Okay? So therefore, we can't even kind of, we have to understand the multidimensional nature of sattva. Okay? Or when you see an artist, and is an amazingly brilliant artist who is totally creative, may not be good at mathematics, but is totally creative, there is sattva there. Okay? That the person is able to manifest art in that form. In order to manifest art, right, the person has to what? Have an amazingly very subtle kind of a mind, which is very sensitive to aesthetics. It's not easy to have that kind of an appreciation. Okay? That is sattva there. Okay? Or you can have great musicians. They're all predominantly sattvic. So you must increase your understanding of who is the person who is exhibiting what? Sattvic qualities. Brilliant, you know, in the way they capture the subtlety and all nuances of music. They use that creativity to render ragas or Western classical music. It doesn't have to be only Indian, right? So it is anybody, a scientist who is totally engaged in finding out reality is from one given aspect a highly sattvic person. Okay. So this sattva itself manifests in different forms. Sattva also manifests in form of your value for dharma. Okay. How much integrated a person are you? What is the importance of value in your life? Okay. So this is where, these are all the qualities of sattvic person. What is rajasic? Rajasic is a person who is more focused on oneself. Okay, so when you're more focused on yourself, you become like the center, right, of everything. So these are the people who are then very ambitious. Okay, that rajasic nature also manifests in many different forms. So some are extremely ambitious, some people are very, very successful, some people, you know, extremely driven, successful people are also mostly rajasic. What we define as success is people who are like, the big achievers, who are predominantly rajasic. Okay. But one has to be careful, because you can also become somebody who is extremely high and highly sattvic too. You can find leaders who are very enlightened leaders. For example, any leader, whether it's a government leader or it's a corporate leader, it's mostly rajasic. Okay? You need to be driven to get things done according to what your plans are. That's not an easy thing to do. Okay? Extremely active, extremely driven, also sometimes into power. At times, it also then can become what? Selfish. Because that's part of, you know, there is one part of rajas which is not bad. This is why you have to become nuanced in your thinking. Okay? Because generally we have a tendency to label. only sattva is good and rajas is bad. No, you need some amount of rajas. Even for example, Gandhi, who was basically a very sattvic person, he needed rajas to bring India to independence, right? Otherwise, you can't accomplish things. So you can't afford to think rajas is only self-centeredness. It's not. Okay, it gives you that drive, it gives you that power, it gives you that commitment to do it. Getting things done is not an easy thing. Okay, so therefore this is what we call rajas. Okay, and then what is the third aspect, and that is what we call tamas. Tamas itself also exhibits, you know, manifests in many different ways. Okay. One way in which tamas manifests is what? Total lack of interest in anything. Or just dullness, not doing enough about anything. So many people say they have this intention and that they have that intention, but they have a lot of difficulty in actually getting done. Even people who are professionals, when I was working with the UN, I saw so many people, they just cannot, you know, you have deadlines and people are just unable to do things according to deadline. And they seem all very busy and they seem, but they are just not productive. Okay, so that means that this kind of a thing is tamasic. Okay? That you are not efficient, you are not able to apply your mind when you decide to do something and you are not able to follow up on that, that is a tamasic mind. Okay? Then tamasic mind can also manifest as lack of what? Ability to understand what is dharma and what is adharma. So therefore, when you are what you do, which is sometimes, sometimes so wrong, you will find, and people don't even realize that they are doing something wrong. You have people who have totally blocked, they have somehow blocked that sensitivity. There is a very genuine and basic confusion within what? Their capacity to distinguish what is dharma and what is adharma. Or it can also manifest as they know what is dharma and what is adharma, but they are unable to follow it. That is also tamas. So tamas also has so many different manifestations, so many different degrees. It's not just one quality itself. This is why you can have people with combinations of these qualities. Okay. You can be a person who is extremely kind and at the same time not doing enough. So you have heightened sense of sattva because you are a sensitive human being. Okay, but you are not, it's not followed by rajas, the drive to do things, being active, being proactive. You are just kind of lax about it. Okay, so that's why we are all combination of all three. You can't categorically say one person is only sattvic, one person is only tamasic, one is only rajasic. You can have highly rajasic people but extremely sattvic too. You have all these big businessmen turning philanthropist. They do big, big philanthropy. They are extraordinary people. You can't just say, oh, they are businessmen. You can't say that. Okay. This is why these days when they have these kind of, you know, very unique dimensional view of things, they don't capture the totality of things. You need to make a mind which is far more nuanced than, you know, these kind of black and white positions that we take. And you can have a tamasic person who also, you can have a tamasic person who is what? A criminal. And driven by what? He's so driven by his what? This wanting to steal. They create amazing strategies, brilliant strategies. So they, it's all powered by rajas. Okay. So this is where you have combination of all three in all every human being. Okay. Now, what is our attempt? When we say you need to grow in order for this bigger picture to be clear, what are you trying to do? you are trying to be predominantly sattvic, right? That is something which is, that's why within this framework, what you are trying to do is trying to be predominantly. You can't eliminate the other two, but you are trying to be predominantly sattvic, okay? Now, you want to be sattvic, but in how? How are you going to be sattvic? Okay, so therefore, even sattva is broken down into categories. See how Vedanta makes you somebody who makes you see a nuance of one thing, then go one step deeper and makes you see further nuance. It breaks it all down so that it gives you certain clarity about how to initiate personal growth. Otherwise, you are told there is this big vision and you have to grow to know this vision and you don't know how. So that means very specific things are talked about which become a guideline. Okay. So now even sattva is further broken down. Okay. So there is one thing which is, it says that there is any action that we do, even within that action, there can be sattva, rajas or tamas. For example, everybody thinks dānam is charity, philanthropy, giving, okay, is a good act. So our mind is such that we say this is a noble act, right? So that means we don't have any nuance in that. What Bhagavad Gita does is, an act which is generally considered to be a good act, it further breaks it down into sattvic, rajas and tamas. It says your dānam can be sattvic, it can be tamasic or it can be rajasic. What is a sattvic dānam? Okay. Sattvic dānam is given for a good cause. Okay. That means that you assess the importance of the cause and you don't hesitate to make your contribution. Because everybody has limited resources, nobody has unlimited resources, right? And there are so many things that require funds. So now you have to make choices. How wise are your choices? Okay, so this is what decides, what are you just giving for, what things which are not well ascertained causes, or you're intelligent in determining the right causes. You get, in fact, nowadays people are very good because they give awards, but you have CSR awards. Okay, so that means every company is doing CSR, but who is making an impact? Who is the most significant, right? Who has identified a right cause, a right intervention where the person can make a significant difference? Okay, so that means it's not enough to have good heart, you need to use your capacity to discern, to make proper decision. Okay, so that is a sattvic charity. And what it says is, in sattvic charity, who is the focus? Where is the focus? The cause is the focus. Okay. After the cause, the person who is receiving is the focus. Okay. So therefore, that is, and there you can exhibit your generosity. If you value something, you have to open. This is what we call expansion of your heart. And if you do it for this, and with this whole arrogance that look at this, look at me, right, and I'm giving this thing, then it ceases to be sattvic. It becomes what? The focus becomes what? You and your name and your recognition as a person who's philanthropist, right? So that means there is a whole big shift. It shifts from the recipient to me and my recognition and my standing in the society. So this is where it becomes rajasic. हैं. एंड देन यू हैव समथिंग कॉल तामसिक गिविंग. तामसिक गिविंग कुड बी व्हेन यू डोंट आइडेंटिफाई योर कॉजेज एक्यूरेटली. When I came to India, I saw how difficult it is. Even now, I don't know why. We have NRO account, and it's so difficult to transfer funds even within India. And I said, why is it so difficult? And that is because so much money comes in from abroad to India, and it is all for charity, but it is used for terrorism. Right? So this is what we call, the person is giving charity, okay, but it is choosing a totally wrong cause. So this becomes what we call tamasic giving. There is no discretion, wrong identification. The wrong causes seem like the right causes. There is a confusion there, confusion of values. Okay, harming somebody becomes what? The very purpose of charity. My God. Okay. So therefore, this is something that even a danam one has to. So that means if I have a tendency to give, I have to ascertain where, and I have to try to be as sattvic as possible. Does it mean that we are condemning rajasic? We are not. We are just saying that a human tendency is to want recognition. That is a human tendency to be recognized, right? But to go to the next step, it requires effort. So that means it then makes me recognize that these are the areas where I need to work. Otherwise, where is the framework? How do I know how to grow? Okay, so this is what we call danam. You can be sattvic. Okay, then it says tapas. This is also very interesting. Okay, tapas is any discipline that you have to evolve as a human being. Generally, all of us and everybody has a tendency to engage in the world. The five sense organs that we are given, they report data. Okay, they report. You have eyes and you can see different forms. You have ears and you can hear sounds. You have nose and you can have different smells. Okay, and you have tongue and you can taste. And you have skin and you can have touch sensation. Okay, so much of our life is just going, and that data that is provided by your sense or captured by your sense organ is limitless. With your eyes, what? How many different forms you can engage in? Okay? When you're going on a vacation and you want to see some mountain in Switzerland, you are actually, what are you doing? It is a gratification of your eye, the sense organ. Really it is. Every pursuit, when you go to a good restaurant, when you go to a good party and have good food, everything is what? Gratification of these sense organs. And what is interesting is there is no end to it. Okay, so we become more and more sophisticated in our choices, and there is no end. So when you start, when we were kids, what? You go to a simple neighborhood restaurant and you're really happy. Okay? Then when you go to New York, then you, oh, you're this just simple neighborhood. You want to go to all these nice, all these cuisines, you know, you want to try Ethiopian cuisine and you want to try Tibetan cuisine, and you are becoming more sophisticated in your whole choice. Then you want the top, you want Michelin, one star restaurant. So you just, it's endless. Okay, and this is how we think that we are evolving and we are becoming more and more sophisticated, more and more refined. It's all nothing but sense gratification. We are becoming subtler, and there is it's just, and then the other people are kind of looked down upon because they haven't yet reached this stage. Okay, whole life is lived like that. Okay, so therefore there is a need. Self-growth means you don't condemn the five sense organs. What you do is you try to gain certain mastery over it so that the sense organs don't take you for a ride, which is an endless ride. Okay, so that means you have mastery, you choose how your sense organs are used, to what extent, in what activity, for how long. So this is what we call the tapas. But even tapas seems like such a good thing to do, right? Because you are gaining certain mastery over your sense organs and you are making it somehow a little bit, you become a master and you decide how, when, what, rather than it taking you away. But even tapas, Bhagavad Gita says, is sattvic, rajas and tamas. How does tapas become sattvic, rajasic and tamasic? Okay. A sattvic tapas is done for what? Your self-growth. Self-growth means that if, without saying that this is, I don't want people to think that, oh, this is all engaging in sense is materialistic pursuit. It is not, we are not calling it materialistic pursuit. This is a natural tendency of everyone. But when you go along with your natural tendencies, then whole life is consumed by that. The brain that is given to you, which can do lot more than that, is wasted. Okay, because a human mind is capable of engaging in a very fundamental inquiry into realities. Inquiry into realities means understanding what is my nature, understanding what is the nature of the cause of the universe, understanding what is my relationship with the cause of the universe, understanding what is the universe and what's my relationship with it, understanding how to live a meaningful life. This is something that a human mind is capable of doing. If you waste that capacity and if you've just kind of given yourself to sense organs, it's a huge waste of human birth. So therefore, this tapas is meant for you to actually make this use of your mind so that you can find out some of the most fundamental answers which enable you to live a proper life. Okay. So if this is your intention for tapas, then it is a sattvic tapas. Because your things are understood at the right place. You are not condemning yourself, oh, I should be. You know, it's not I should stay away from things. It's not I should be. What I can do as a human being is a lot more than what I'm doing. And it is my responsibility to what? Do what I can do, to live a meaningful life. And I cannot live a meaningful life if I just indulge in superficial things. Okay, so therefore this becomes a sattvic tapas, proper understanding of why and what. Why tapas? Otherwise, you want to do tapas, but if somebody asks you why, you fumble, you don't even know. So many things we do without even understanding why. Okay, so also when things are understood, this is what we call sattvic tapas. What is rajasic tapas? Rajasic tapas is when you want to exhibit all what you want to be recognized as the yogi, the person who has all these different tapas powers, and you what use your whatever little powers that you have and you make a big show of it, you make people dependent upon you. The whole thing is your fame game. So this is where anybody who is wanting to recognize that recognition as a big yogi, there is a need there. The center is not my growth, but what is the center? Me. You want to go to yoga class because you want to have a perfect body and you want to show off. This is rajasic. Okay. So this is what is, it's not bad, or we are not saying bad, this is a human tendency. So things are all skewed for just my benefit. The whole perception of the world and one's interaction is skewed to manipulate the world for one's benefit. Okay, so that becomes tamasic, that becomes rajasic tapas. Okay, what is tamasic tapas? Tamasic tapas is when you inflict pain on yourself. Okay, a discipline in eating is a very positive thing. Anorexia, bulimia is tamasic. You don't have proper relationship with food. Okay, so you are somehow exercising some kind of a control over your tendency to eat, but it has reached a very distorted kind of a, it has become highly distorted in its function. It is consuming you instead of helping you. Okay, so therefore, one thing that I realized when I went to the US, and that is, and unfortunately I see it here now, that the relationship people had with food. When I first went in '80s, it was amazing, because in India I generally thought, at least the people that I saw, they enjoy eating, they love, they like to, you know, have good food, and they like proper relationship with it. Okay, then there, every time a woman sat on the table, she was on a guilt trip. Oh, how many calories? Oh my God, I'll get fat. People are so obsessed with that, they just don't have a healthy relationship with food. Food is something which is there to nurture you. You cannot exist without food. Every organ of your body requires multiple things for its survival that you gain through food. Okay, you have to respect food. You can't afford to have an unhealthy, one-dimensional relationship with the food. Okay, and also this is where what is very nice is in our where we study. Okay, before eating we make this very nice prayer. Okay, it's from chapter 4 of Gita, you must have heard it. Okay, it says brahmarpanam brahma havihi brahmagnau brahmana hutam brahmaivatena gantavyam brahma karma samadhina. Beautiful prayer. Okay, it says that the whole ritual of eating is like a yajna. Yajna means it's a Vedic ritual, where it says that the food which is offered to the fire of your digestive fire, that food is Brahman. Your digestive fire is also Brahman. Okay, the process through which you are what? Making, offering, that's the food, whatever, you know, you're holding your hand, that is also Brahman. The possibilities that make the food what it is and gives all the different nutrients to you, that is also Brahman. The whole thing is totality is Brahman. And when you begin to see Brahman in everything, that is the time that you are ready for understanding Brahman. Because you don't exclude anything from this Brahman. The whole arrangement is something which is extraordinary arrangement. Your body requires nutrients and the plants through what? Photosynthesis can get all the different energies and to give you everything that you need. What the nutritionist, what B1 and B2 and B12, everything is through this process. The whole arrangement is Brahman. Within that, you nourish, you thank all the forces, and you show your responsibility of nourishing yourself. This is proper relationship. Not just, oh, how many calories and I'll get fat. What kind of vision of life is this? So this is where, this is what we call, we become sattvic. Sattvic means we become alive to realities. We give proper attention to proper things. Okay. So that means from me and what it will do for me in a very narrowly defined sense, you have to evolve to see the totality and do what needs to be done. Don't abuse your body too, because it's something which is given to you. You can't overeat and abuse it either. Okay. So that means this is rajasic, tamasic, and what is tamasic food? The tapas, sorry, tamasic tapas. Tamasic tapas is, yeah, as I said, when you inflict pain on yourself. Okay. Sometimes you see also that people, you have this whole thing of people hit themselves and people do all kinds of crazy things, right? So this is where you, when you begin to actually cause pain to you, you have responsibility towards your body. You can't abuse your body. Okay. Tapas is meant for disciplining so that you have time for higher things, not for getting abusing your body. Okay. So therefore, this is what we call tamasic tapas. Then there is the other thing, which is, sorry, okay, what we call ahara. Ahara is food. Okay. Ahara is sattvic, rajasic, and tamasic. Okay. So generally, we think that food is an activity, eating food is an activity that we perform how many times a day? Minimum, at least two, three times a day. Okay? And the choices that you make about that food also shows your disposition, how you are, what kind of a thinker you are. Okay? So therefore, what is sattvic food is, as Bhagavad Gita says, it is fresh. That is the first condition. Okay, our teacher used to make fun that you don't have 5-day-old food. That is tamasic. Okay, in Chinese, a thing also they say that the food, I think, few hours after cooking, it loses its qi. Qi is something which is like energy. It just becomes calories. Okay, so therefore, this sattvic food is always fresh foods. okay, not very, very pungent, not very, which is totally kind of, you know, bombarding your digestive system. They're easy to digest. Why are you wanting to have things which are easy to digest? Because your whole time, if it is spent in digesting your food, but at the time of digestion, all your blood is what? In your, so that means you don't have enough time to think about things. See, the whole thing is you want to be a sattvic person to be able to understand this final reality about yourself. You have to put that in perspective. Being sattvic is not an end, it's a means to an end. Unless you are a sattvic person, you can't understand that bigger reality about yourself. Okay, so therefore, this, if you eat very heavy foods, if you eat things which are very pungent, which are just really taxing your whole system, then so much of your time goes in dealing with that food, so then you're not available to do other things. Okay, so sattvic is a light, fresh, healthy food is what we call sattvic food. What is rajasic food? Something which actually is extremely pleasing for your senses, right? You have very tasty food, little, you know, people who are used to a lot of spices or lot of chilies or lot of ginger, they find all the other food what, like very dull and very boring, right? So that means it gives some instantaneous pleasure to your, so the whole focus of the food is what, how good it tastes. That becomes the criteria. That means it's again a much more short-term way of having a relationship with the food. Okay? What my grandmother used to tell me is, you know, as you are young, you always like fatty food and you like deep fried things. This is everybody. Everybody likes that. Okay? So instead of telling me not to eat and don't do this and don't do that, she very quietly, she told me, she says, you know, that your whole commitment, I mean not me, she says, you know, when you are eating and you are not thinking, the whole commitment is how it will taste here, right? After it goes, and how long does the food stay here? Seconds. Right? How long it stays here is seconds, and you totally ignore what is it is going to do after it goes here. So that means it's a very short term gratification, very short term pleasure orientation.
Yeah, they say second on the list, forever on the
list. Is that what it is? Oh my God. Okay, so this is what we call, the orientation is self-gratification, so that's why it becomes rajasic. It can be very tasty, it can give a lot of pleasures, but it's only for seconds, right? So this is what we call rajasic food. What is tamasic food? Tamasic food, as I told you, is, you know, this old foods that we eat, dead foods. Okay. Dead foods which are like kept for, our teacher used to always make fun that, you know, he has ashram in Pennsylvania. So sometimes all these couples come and the wife says that I'm going to India for 3 weeks and all that. So somebody is just asking, yeah, so then what will he eat, right? He says, yeah, I've packed everything. For 3 weeks, we packed everything. And says, yeah, I've prepared all these, you know, I've labeled everything. So the woman is like so happy describing him, and it's like, my God, he's eating 3 week old food is not a good idea at all, right? So this is where it's what we call dead food. Okay. Another thing is also, I mean, now that I'm talking about it, In any food where you take life of a living being, that becomes tamasic food. Okay? Why? Because it is true that jivaha jivasya bhojanam. This is true. okay, you cannot totally avoid, because even if you take vegetarian food, it is also living. So you can't totally avoid harming. Okay, but you can choose how much harm you are going to do. You can try to minimize it. Okay? If you're indifferent that that what you eat, and somebody has to give up their life and you don't care, that shows a certain type of insensitivity, that you don't care. Okay, generally what happens is, it's not even that people don't care, they don't think about it. Okay, they don't think about, because they, when they see the food, what comes on their plate is just, you know, very well decorated, some piece, and you don't think what has happened. Okay, so therefore somebody was saying, somebody had become vegetarian, so I asked her, I said, why did you become vegetarian? And she told me in one sentence. Generally people give a long lecture of why they are vegetarian. She gave me a very nice, and it really struck my mind. She said that if slaughterhouses had glass doors, nobody will be a vegetarian, a non-vegetarian. That's enough. Okay? Because you don't, if you begin to see what happens, and you begin to see the fear that the poor animal is going through, is seen the previous one being slaughtered with all the blood, and my is the next turn. What happens? The kind of suffering. Okay? And that becomes your food, and what it is going to do to you. That is right. So that means when tamasic food also is what? When you take somebody's life and you don't think about it, that is tamas. Okay. So this is where you have, people, this is why you want to be sattvic, so you can have people who are extremely, for example, giving charities and all, but in this area they haven't thought about it. So when you are breaking it down, and if you're creating so many subcategories, then it's easier for you to identify where is it that you need to go, without labeling yourself as, oh, I'm like this or I'm like that. It just tells you, okay, now here I need to pay attention, here I need to pay attention. So it enables you to initiate this self-growth. Okay? And it is not to condemn yourself, and it is also not to point fingers at others. Because what unfortunately happens is, the minute we start talking about sattva, rajas, tamas, out people go and they change their whole vocabulary. Oh, he's eating tamasic food and she's rajasic. So that means you continue to be highly judgmental. You continue to create all these bipolar things, right? And you just have changed your vocabulary. This is how we don't grow. Because every knowledge, we make it into an information and don't apply it rightly. It is meant for you to assess which are the areas in which you need to grow. It is not meant for you to give names to others, or even to give name to yourself, oh, I am tamasic. It's not for that. Because it's very important, because there are so many people who eat meat and they get a complex when something like this is talked about. They immediately feel that they are tamasic. Immediately. Okay? The purpose of this is not to make them feel bad or anything. It's just, the purpose is, many things we do out of habit where we don't give enough thought. So here you make the person think about it, and once that person is thinking about it, the person is left to make one's own choices. It's not like you are bad if you're doing this. That is not at all the intention. So it just gives you different areas in which you need to grow. and you have to make use of this framework to initiate your growth. Okay, so this is what he says. And the person who has made more effort towards being sattvic is the person who is becoming more eligible towards this knowledge. Okay. Now, what the next verse is talking about is this whole process of growing and knowing the final reality. Okay, so where does it all end? Okay, so the next verse is chapter 15, verse 2 and 3. Okay. Here he says, अदश्चोद्वं प्रसुतातस्य शाखाः गुणप्रवृद्धा विषयप्रवालाः अदश्च मूलान्यनुसन्ततानि कर्माणुबन्धीनि मनुष्यलोके. सो दिस पर्टिक्युलर वर्स इज गिविंग यू एन एनालॉजी इन फॉर्म ऑफ अ ट्री. ओके, अ ट्री is considered, it is equated to samsara. Samsara means this life of becoming. Life of becoming is such that you see the tree and you only see the tree, you don't recognize what? The roots. Okay? Generally, what is available for you to see is the tree, and you want to eliminate the tree. What will you, if you just cut the trunk, what will happen? The tree will grow again. Okay, so this is how every time you cut either the branch or a trunk or any flower or any thing, what, you are not getting rid of the tree. Okay, so that means sattva, rajas and tamas, our whole purpose is not only to become sattvic, because becoming sattvic is still what? Within samsara itself. You become more sattvic, you become more evolved in your choices, and for those choices that you make, you get what? Better results. So that means when you get better results, what happens? You come in this world with more what? Privileged. Anything that you have in this world, please recognize it as something which is a privilege that is given to you because some good action that you have done in the past. It doesn't just come like that. Any wealth that you have, please don't regard it as materialistic thing. Welcome it as Lakshmi. Resource, it comes not just like that. Good looks, punya, okay, scholarship, brilliant, punya, okay, any talent, any skill, any privilege, it's all result of punya. Okay, so more punya you have, relatively better birth you have in many different directions. Okay, but your whole purpose of life is not to just have more punya to have better and better life. That is the basic difference between anything else and Vedanta. Okay? What it says is, yes, that is good. Relatively, it will give you certain comforts, it will give you certain privileges, some resources, access to bright brilliance. But the whole thing is what? To cut that whole tree. Get out of this samsara. This is the vision, the Vedic vision of human goal. The ultimate human goal is not to continue indefinitely and have more and more sattva. The Vedic vision is to cut, eliminate this tree forever. Samsara vruksha. Life of becoming is something which is considered to be like a imprisonment. Okay. There was a very nice quote by Albert Einstein. He made this quote by saying that there is actually, I mean, with all his physics, he got an insight into bigger picture. Okay. So what he said is, in fact, we are all connected human beings. The whole world is just series of things which are connected in its one entirety. And he says that we somehow create artificial limit, and we highly confine that consciousness to this little entity, and whole life we live being imprisoned by our imaginary walls that we create. Okay, so the ultimate goal of human life is to be in touch with real reality about myself. Okay, so that is Urdhvamoola Madashakam Ashwattham Prahuravyayam Chandamsi Yasya Parnani Yastam Vedasa Vedavila Manushyaloke Karmani Bandhini. Okay. Manushyaloke means if your whole thing is just to be a sattvic, you are still within karma bandha. Okay. So therefore, what the next verse is saying is what? Na rupamasyeha tathopalabhyate nanto na chadir na cha sampratishtha ashvatthamenam suvirudhamulam asangashastrena dridhena chitva. It says the whole purpose of life is to totally what? Samulena. Uproot this Ashwattha tree, and not to, because through your sattvic action you are actually what? Continuing that tree, samsara. Okay, so therefore, what is the moola? What is the moola? If you want to eliminate the tree, where is it that you need to intervene? At the level of roots. Okay, so therefore, if you want freedom from bondage, which is caused by karma, karma means action. Action will produce two types of result, seen and unseen result. The unseen result, in order for you to experience, you have to come back again as an individual. When you come back as an individual, there is nobody who is only doing good acts. So you have both punya and papa. So you have relatively privileged births, but you are always bound. Okay. So the purpose is to totally be free from life of becoming. Life of becoming is like this vruksha. The one body goes, next body comes. That body goes, third body comes. Infinite experiences. Okay. So therefore, how do you uproot that? And the only way to uproot is to recognize, here he uses the analogy. Okay. What is the ultimate thing that you will have to do? What is the moola? You look at the tree and you negate its total reality. One is the root you take out. There is the other thing is, while the tree is there, you take out its reality, in the sense that if I ask you, what is tree? What will you say? What is tree? Exactly. So that means, now I will say, trunk is not the tree, so let me take out the trunk. Leaves are not the tree, let me take out the leaves. Flowers are not the tree, let me take out the flowers. The branches are not the tree, let me take out the branches. You show me where is the tree. Tree, while it exists, you can understand that it is a name for many different things put together. Okay. Then you go back to another part. and you say the trunk. Where is the trunk? What is the trunk? What is the trunk? There's all just all these atoms running around with mostly space. Without those atoms, there is no trunk. Okay, so therefore, even this trunk is really not really a trunk. Look at the leaves. What are the leaves? See. Okay, so that means in a tree you have forms within forms within forms within forms, infinite. Okay, once you understand there are forms within forms within forms, then what is it that upon which all these different forms depend for their existence? That is the question. Okay, so this is where he says, "Na rupam asyeha tathopalabhyate." When you inquire into the nature of the tree, there is no tree, it disappears. It's only through inquiry. So, if you want to free yourself from bondage of what? Samsara, you inquire, who am I? Who is doing karma and getting results of this karma? What is the nature of I? Exactly. Absolutely. Right? So that means this is when you realize, yes, there is an individual performing a karma. Just like there is a tree. You can't totally deny that there is a tree. There is this individual, but what about this individual is I? Okay, the body is something which is known to me, just as this is atom, this is also atoms. Okay, and everybody knows that atom is not I. Then the whole body, which is what? Changing cells constantly. Okay, is not I. What about the mind with which I have so much identification as I? Because every action that you do for which you have to experience the result, when you say I do an action, you require what? Your body and you require your mind. As long as your I is in your body and mind and you take it as a reality, you are bound by karma phala. Result of that action. You have to come back and experience result of that action. Okay, so that mind is also something which is nothing but thoughts, and they are changing all the time. Any thought, you try to hold on to it. How long will you hold on to it? Even, right? Not long. Seconds. Okay. So therefore, even the mind is something which is changing all the time. So any karma that you do, can you do without body and mind? No. So that means the karma is done at the level of body and mind. And as long as your I is in that body and mind, you are subject to karma phala. You are not free from the cycle of birth and death. Okay? The only way to get out of this karma and karma phala is to understand neither I am the body nor I am the mind with which the actions are done. Who am I? I am the awareness because of which different conditions of my body are known, different conditions of my mind are known. And in that awareness, there is no action in the first place. That awareness has never performed any action. It can never perform any action. It is because of which, what? the body and mind performs an action. This is the only way, right? You have to become sattvic, but with a sattvic mind, you need to what? Figure out your true nature. That is why being sattvic is not an end in itself. A sattvic mind is able to undertake this inquiry without any what? Ambiguity. In fact, as Rashmi was saying, everybody's experience when they first listen to Vedanta is like this. One of my students in Bangkok, she used to say it seemed like Star Wars, it seemed like some fantasy when you are told that you are limitless. What is that, right? But slowly you cultivate your mind and you begin to understand, oh my God, you know what it says is not just some fantasy, it is so profound. Okay, so that means you have made your mind ready enough to be able to understand this reality. So that means this sattvic is readiness of the mind to then ultimately what? Cut the whole vruksha. The whole samsara vruksha you cut. Through inquiry, sattvic mind is for that inquiry to culminate into proper understanding of reality, which enables you to discover your true nature without any vagueness, without any ambiguity, without any error. Okay, and to know yourself as totally free. So this is what this next verse is saying, and that is, and for that it says what? Asanga shastrena dridena chitva. The shastra, the instrument with which you uproot this tree of samsara, what is the instrument here? Your mind. Mind is an instrument because mind is the place where inquiry takes place. Mind is the place where ignorance is. Mind is the place where ignorance has to go. So if you don't have a cultivated mind, it will distort things. It will not understand it accurately. So the mind is an instrument and that has to be ready for this samsara to be uprooted. Okay, so this is why in the next verse, it says, this mind which is ready, which is sattvic. Now, sattvic mind, you know, it's difficult to cultivate a sattvic mind. So, it is talking about sattvic mind from many different standpoints so that you capture the totality of what sattvic mind is. What is a mind which is prepared for this inquiry? Which is the mind which can actually, you know, capture this reality? Okay. So the next two verses is further describing about the type of mind which is not able to get this knowledge. Okay, so you can't ignore this preparation. So here he says, he puts it differently. He says, if you have a mind like this, you cannot understand this reality. Okay, so it says, ahankaram balam darpam kamam krodham cha samshritaha mamatma paradeheshu pradvinsho abhyasuyakaha tanaham dvishatah kruran samsareshu naradaman kshipramya jasrama shubhan asureshveshu yonishu. He says that this verse I will do next time because it's almost 10 to 7 and you want it to go. Okay. So now it is using a different type of a mind and it says, as long as your mind is afflicted with these kind of values, then it is not ready. You take it the other way. So that means you examine it from many different standpoints to get grip over how to become a mature person. So one needs to get rid of these tendencies. What are those tendencies? Which he describes as asuri tendencies. Asura, generally when you watch mythology, yeah, Asura is this person who's, you know, this big horrible guy, right? And here he says all of us have some sides which are highly sattvic and other asuri tendencies are within all of us. Okay, so that means this is what in modern psychology we call it the dark side. The dark side everybody has, the unconscious. Unconscious need not only be dark, but a lot of things are stored unaddressed, which sometimes take over our behavior and makes us do things which we later on say this is not the right thing that I did. Okay, so one needs to address those tendencies. You can't just let them lie there saying I am everything doesn't work unless you've taken care of all these things. Okay, so what are these things that one needs to take care of, that we will see next time. Om Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi. Om.